Hey everyone, and welcome to Storytime. My name is Jake, and today we are going to be looking at the subreddit r/prorevenge, where people tell us their best stories on when they got revenge on someone or something they didn't like. If you're new around here, please do hit subscribe down below so that you never miss out on another video. But for now, let's sit back, relax, and enjoy some prorevenge stories. Don't screw with the crew. Back in the early 90s, I got a gig working as a front-of-house sound engineer on a major 10-day music and arts festival in London's Docklands, with some 15 stages dotted all around the waterfront. All of the crew working the stages were either experienced theatre techs and/or had loads of experience working major outside events, which is the reason we were hired. As an aside, this festival was to celebrate the culmination of a massive investment in the redevelopment of this area of East London, itself the former site of one of the largest dock complexes in the world. I was tasked with running FOH sound on one of the largest stages. Normally, events like this are loads of fun to work, but within 2 days it became apparent that the organisers had 1, no idea of how to run major outside events, and 2, had not the faintest idea of how to book acts and schedule same. In particular, we also had to contend with some woman from Docklands' middle management team who had been given the job of overseeing our particular stage. A person who not only had rapidly proved to be totally ignorant of any aspect of managing outside events, but also someone for whom the word entitled had been invented. Our stage was licensed to run events from midday until 10 p.m, but we rarely had a full day's worth of events for punters to enjoy, due to the aforementioned incompetence with booking. Still not our problem, we'll just work with what's given us. On the Thursday, we had scheduled an evening of old-time Victorian music hall, which featured, as a special guest, a very famous film and TV actress. Her performance rider required a grand piano. For some unfathomable reason, and again due to the incompetence of the organisers, the piano, a full-size Yamaha Concert Grand, arrived from the hire company on the Tuesday. This was a remarkably stupid idea for any number of reasons. Due to operational considerations, we had to store the piano in the backstage area, where it spent 2 days suffering in the heat of the day, despite our best efforts to shield it. As any piano technician and tuner will tell you, this is an extremely bad idea, especially with an instrument worth close to £100,000. Almost as bad was the fact that our area was a little more than a roughly graded building site. The ground was covered in hardcore rubble fragments around the size of hen's eggs, very uncomfortable to walk around on, even with proper work boots, which also kicked up loads of dust and other detritus. Not the sort of stuff you want floating about gumming up the works of a very expensive concert grand. Now, let me properly set the scene. It's midsummer, very hot, and our venue is a large circus-style tent with around 800-seat capacity. The cast of the show, along with our August star, were due to turn up at around 1 p.m. to conduct a production rehearsal so we could sort out sound and lighting cues for the show. The main cast duly turn up on time, and we start sorting out their technical requirements. Pretty simple and nothing that we're not used to. At about 1:30 p.m, our star turns up, sporting dark glasses and an immaculate couture. As anyone who's worked in this industry knows, the initial interaction with a major A-list star, vis-a-vis their technical requirements, can go one of two ways: full Monty Diva, or let's go with what we have. Her first demand was that the piano be dropped off the front of the stage so that she could maintain an eyeline while standing right downstage, both with her pianist and with the audience. The stage was about 4.5 feet above ground level and would have required at least 8 burly lads to safely shift a full-size concert grand off the desk. Also not a good idea, since it had been tuned that morning, and moving it would have almost certainly caused the tuning to go out of whack. I delicately pointed out that doing so would be in direct violation of both health and safety and fire regulations, as per our written policy, as it would have put the piano in both the fire lane and close to one of the primary emergency exits from the venue. Thinking rapidly, I then suggest that we place the piano as far downstage as physically possible, and that she page herself 3 or 4 feet upstage so that she could still glance over and take cues from her MD while still taking in the audience. The tension was palpable. After a few seconds consideration, she replied, "No problem, I can work with that." Phew. No sooner than this crisis had been averted, that the Docklands rep rocked up. I remind you, gentle reader, that this person had absolutely zero knowledge about how to run an outside event. She had also been a major thorn in our side for the previous week, trying to micromanage proceedings in the venue in order to big herself up in front of her bosses. We, of course, completely ignored her suggestions, but in such a way as made her think she was in charge. Trust me, she wasn't. She had also been inexcusably rude to virtually every single member of the crew from day one, and had over the days previous reduced several of them to tears. Production crews don't take kindly to our own being treated in such a cavalier fashion. And while we're generally fairly thick-skinned, there comes a point where we want to get our own back. Believe me, after a week of constant abuse, we were coming up with creative ways of disposing of the body. Although we didn't realize it at the time, our savior was at hand, but I digress. Obviously starstruck, she announced in gushing tones that she would be taking personal charge of our star's every need, and that we were not to concern ourselves with that aspect. Indeed, we were to keep our place, as we were only the hired help. Our stage manager, who was at the time sweeping the stage, bridled at the suggestion and made as if to use his broom to beat the brains out of this woman. I had to step in front of him as unobtrusively as possible and stop him from burying the woman right then and there. She ain't worth it, mate. She then swanned off, leaving our star slack-jawed in amazement. She then turned to me and said, "Is that woman for real?" I replied, "Darling, you have no idea." At which point she laughed uproariously. I gave our star a brief summary of the previous few days farrago, and instantly she became one of us, and from then on, we were all on first name terms. We then ran a full tech rehearsal from 3 p.m. to 5 p.m, sorted out all of our cues, and then repaired to the beer tent with the cast for a spot of late lunch and a drink or two. The show was scheduled to kick off at 7:30 p.m. At around 6 p.m, the harridan reappeared to overlook the situation. She noticed that we had all the sides of the tent raised in order to get some air flowing through. Remember, it's midsummer and it's currently low to mid 80s. She then demanded that all of the tent flaps be lowered because she wanted a more theater atmosphere and the light spilling through the side walls would spoil the effect. Despite pointing out that dropping the tent sides would significantly raise the temperature in the venue, she demanded the sides be dropped. So, despite our earnest advice to the contrary, we reluctantly complied. At around 7 p.m, we saw 8 50-seat coaches arrive. To our amazement, out from the coaches came an entire flotilla of old-age pensioners. Many on Zimmer frames, who proceeded to shuffle their way into the tent across the hardcore rubble underfoot. We discovered later that the organizers had forgot to advertise the event anywhere, seriously? And in desperation, had gone around to all the local Darby and Joan clubs a couple of days before, handing out free tickets and laying on transport in order to have an audience. So now we have 400 odd OAPs, frantically fanning themselves with anything to hand as the temperature climbs ever so higher. We start the show. Everything's going fine, but the mercury in the thermometer I have strapped to the FOH rack is slowly going up and up. It's so hot at the sound of the desk that I'm down to my shorts. By the end of Act 1, the temperature has gotten up to around 94 Fahrenheit, and one could clearly see the old dears are in a bit of distress. Naturally, the organizers have neglected to provide water for the public, and judging by the horrified expressions of the two St. John Ambulance first aiders stationed either side of the stage, things were about to get a lot worse. I climbed off the tower, found the rigging crew, and ordered the sides of the tent raised. No sooner had I done so than our friend, standing nearby, demanded that the sides stay down because she was in charge and her instructions were to be followed absolutely, no questions. It was at this juncture that diplomacy went completely out the window. I informed her in no uncertain terms, and employing a fair amount of Anglo-Saxon vernacular, that it was in fact the crew who had the responsibility of ensuring the health and safety of all the people in the venue, not her, and that we have the legal authority to enact any procedure that we see fit at any time to ensure the safety and well-being of everyone present. I then informed her that I was now exercising my authority under the Health and Safety at Work Act 1974 to remediate the situation, and that if she made one single attempt to circumvent that authority, I would have her ejected from the venue without hesitation. She then got in my face and screamed, "I'm in charge." No strike one, no strike two, instant strike three. I glanced over at two of our security crew who had been hovering in the background with huge smug grins on their faces, who then stepped up either side of her, defeated but complaining like a banshee with a terminal case of hemorrhoids, she was escorted off the premises in short order. By the time Act 2 kicked off, we'd gotten the temperature down to a much more manageable low 70 Fahrenheit, much to the appreciation of our audience, and the rest of the show went off without a hitch. After the show, cast and crew, including our orga star, repaired to the bar for a well-earned drink. Moments later, you know who appeared, and in imperious tones informed us that our star was to be the guest of honor at a VIP reception for the various Docklands bigwigs. With a tinge of regret for having our fun curtailed prematurely, we said our goodbyes to our star. Now it gets interesting. Not 10 minutes later, she storms back into the beer tent with a face like absolute thunder. Taken somewhat aback by her reappearance, we inquired as to why she had returned. "That woman, she drags me off to this so-called VIP party. I get there, and all that's there are two plates of curled up ham sandwiches and two boxes of cheap wine from Sainsbury's. How the holy heck did she get this job?" I gave her a right earful and came back here because I'd much rather drink with you guys. At which point, she calls the barman over and orders a round for the entire crew. We spent the rest of the evening chatting away like old friends. She regaled us with stories of her life, and she was gracious enough to listen to some of ours. Despite us trying to buy her a drink, she refused point blank and picked up the entire bar tab for the rest of the evening on the basis that, "You've had to put up with that evil witch all week. The least I can do is get you folks a drink." All good things must come to an end, and at the end of the evening, her chauffeur turns up to take her home. She embraces all of us as old friends. She hugs me, plants a big kiss on my lips, and thanks me, whereupon I comment, "You have just fulfilled a boyhood dream." Again, that uproarious laugh. She looks at me and says, "Don't let that witch get you down. Leave it to me." I later discovered through the back channels some weeks later that our Beth Noir had been fired from her five-figure job for her monstrous screw-up, primarily because our star's agent had ripped the organizers a new one in very short order. You do not mess with someone of our star's track record without there being consequences. So, although we were not directly responsible for the Harridan's demise, we were gratified to have someone of our star's caliber standing up for us. Revenge is a best dish served cold. I have to say, this story right here was really good, but I had to Google a lot of the words in there, but I guess my vocabulary is ever expanding now. Hey everyone, I hope you all had a really good day and that you enjoyed that video. If you want to check out some other videos, then click on screen right now or check out the playlist down below. If you enjoyed that video, then please do leave a like. And if you want to submit your own stories, then you can do so by joining the Discord in the top link in the description. But thank you so much for watching, and I will see you very soon.